In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. So let me begin by straightening out your cognitive dissonance. Why did we sing, "Give Me That Old Time Religion," when this morning's sermon is, "Don't Give Me That Old Time Religion"? Well, I think it's good and important to say that I'm not going to throw the baby out with the bathwater. That there are some things about old time religion that were noble and good. Remember that it helped to house, educate, feed, and nurture individuals and families for many, many generations, literally thousands of years. In fact, the old adage about the church was that it would be with us from the cradle to the grave, with us in the sense that when we encounter life's most important challenges, our faith and those who also believed in our faith would be there to help us, to draw us closer to God's loving embrace. But there were other things, and there are other things that are not so good and noble, and which come with old-time religion. Old-time religion brought us the Crusades, the Inquisition, religious wars, which I would argue continue to this day. Sadly, it was religion that oppressed women and had an active hand in promoting slavery of fellow human beings, and did its best, its very best, to deny some of the wonderful understandings that have come to us through science. In the gospel reading a moment ago, you can hear how Jesus seems to be dissatisfied with his religion and its old-time component. It's the clergy and the elders of Jesus' day who are finding a way, or at least trying to find a way, to stop Jesus, to prevent him from bringing what we all need so much: healing, wholeness, and a way to draw nearer to God's love. But what really upset the clergy was the large following Jesus had accumulated by then. And this common folk who followed him began to understand and to experience just how near God was to them, and that all they had to do was to open their hearts in faith, and miracles happened right then and there. In other words, Jesus was telling them their old-time religion had to change, had to have a metanoia, a change of mind and heart. So it's no wonder that the clergy and elders were on his case. But I think what annoyed Jesus the most was an old-time religion which stifled God's Spirit. But in a very particular way, with overly oppressive rules, rules that separated people from the very things God wants us to have. Instead of offering the healing presence and liberating mercy of God, the people got more rules, more things not to do or to do. They got laws, laws which demanded sacrifice and adherence. How many laws, you may ask? 613. I've mentioned this before. 365 do not do's in the laws, and the rest are do. And you don't need to be a genius to know that's one for every day of the year, the do not do's. But the people of Israel were required to follow all of them to the letter, to be in right relationship with God. Now, I don't know about you, but I have trouble keeping the Ten Commandments, let alone 603 others. But most of us understand the need for laws in our life. We understand, at the very least, that they help us to do and remember things that are important and that we hope will keep us near God, to live in harmony with ourselves as well. What frustrated Jesus was the people who forgot that religious laws are made for people and not people for religious laws. He tried to show that loving God means to live with the spirit of the law and not just the letter. And he opened people's eyes to see that their old-time religion actually kept them from finding the God they so desperately needed. That's the irony. And he was very clear that they were going to have to leave some of those things behind in order to move closer to God. Again, change their minds. And there are a lot of things that fall into that category in Jesus' mind which still resonate to this day in old-time religion. Especially the one where religion finds license to condemn others. What that amounts to is Jesus taught his followers to rethink their propensity to be judgmental and, one might often say, obnoxious. And I think that's true in our day. How can we expect our faith to grow, to find any kind of traction in people's lives, if we invite them to join this faith and then judge them at the same time? Jesus wouldn't tolerate that. He told the church authorities to leave judgment to God and to stop condemning others because they happened to find God alive in places they'd forgotten to look. You might say that his words this morning, tax collectors and the prostitutes are going to the kingdom of God ahead of you, is his indictment. God is not interested in how good we are at judging others or how often we judge ourselves. God is interested, God is passionate about our finding out how much God desires us and loves us. And I think one of the great beauties of our faith is that we don't get to judge ourselves, let alone anyone else. But we all know someone, some religious types who are judgmental, arrogant, obnoxious. In fact, it's surprising the number of people who are that way who do gravitate to religion. But the same was true in Jesus' day. They had all the right answers. They thought they were holier than Jesus. And they managed to condemn those who didn't agree with them. And I believe that's what actually came about and killed Jesus. We have to leave behind judgmental positions. We have to surrender our arrogance and certainly learn how not to be obnoxious in others' eyes. Why? Because that's what our Savior preached and practiced. Another aspect of old-time religion I still hear today is the belief that God has caused such and such disaster to occur. You heard that one? Storms, earthquakes, bad accidents, even human tragedies, personal ones. It is not God's will that, for instance, the people of Haiti or Japan face terrible devastation because of natural devastation. It is not God's will. Nor is it God's will that a child should die of strangulation on the cords of a window blind while his mom was in the next room. Very early on in my ministry, I was called upon to help a young family deal with just such a tragedy. And for the very reason. And I don't know how many times I heard, I hope well-meaning people, tell an inconsolable mom that it was God's will that her son be taken from her. Or that the child's death was all part of God's plan. It was no wonder to me that she doubted that God existed. It was not God's will that her child die that way, or God's plan that they should suffer such debilitating grief and guilt. That little boy died because people largely were unaware of the dangers of such things. At that time, there weren't warnings sold with these blinds saying, be careful of this, or videos on YouTube detailing precisely how to tie this up so that it doesn't happen. A faith that blames God for the death of an innocent child or thinks it's part of God's plan, I think, needs to rethink Jesus' teachings in a big way. Just because bad things happen to people does not mean that God caused them to happen. Jesus taught that, and we need to know that. There are things that happen because they can happen. What God does when such things happen is carry us through the pain we experience, both in faith and with the hands of others who comfort us, we hope. Knowing that just as God suffered in the suffering of Jesus Christ, so does God suffer with us when we come up against that which we cannot explain. Old-time religion tells us that if we spare the rod, we spoil the child. But if we listen carefully to Jesus' words today and read between the lines in the gospel, we hear him tell a story to the clergy and elders of his day that speaks of a father who does not discipline the sons, even though it was warranted. In fact, a child who spoke out or neglected to obey a parent in Jesus' day could be stoned to death. I believe that if we're going to listen to Jesus, we have to end such forms of punishment, corporal punishment. End the notion that to teach a child that such things are wrong by hitting them doesn't make sense. Yet the Christian church in many cases encourages and in many places sustains corporal punishment. Religious institutions which condone spanking and other forms of corporal punishment as corrective behavior. Have you noticed that it's old-time religion which overwhelmingly calls out for punitive methods of correction in criminal justice systems? Before I point the finger of judgment at them, I must remind myself that it's in my lifetime that it was my own Anglican church, our Anglican church, which systematically abused Aboriginal children in residential schools. That's old-time religion, and we are still paying for it. I could go on a lot longer about such things which old-time religion embraces and we've got to leave behind, but our purpose today should be to repaint religion in ways that bring life to people, not just to us, but to others, to switch from familiar images that are pasted all over the media of narrow judgment and condemnation to alternative expressions of grace which God offers the world every day and which we really need. We are people who know and rely on God's grace and forgiveness, so we have to lift the negative impression, the shroud which hangs over religion, and tell people that we do not reject science and its gift to human knowledge. We do not reject those who doubt for any reason, including personal tragedies, and that we've learned to see doubt as a way to greater understanding. And we do not condemn others because, as Jesus has taught us, we judge not, lest we be judged. People are yearning. People are thirsty. They are missing something greater to believe in than what they have in their lives now. And I'm convinced that we are hardwired to look beyond ourselves and find God, that our calling as Christians today and our opportunity is to offer a faith to people who are thirsty for God and let them drink. The world needs to see that we love God with our hearts, our hands, and our heads, and to offer it to others in the same way Jesus did, in love. So the question now for us, I think, is What is it that we can hold on to in our faith? What are the things we can offer others that will help them find life the way I hope you've found it? We have to hold on to the questions that are hard to answer, but need answering in our lives. Am I accepted for who I am? Why do people suffer if there is a loving God? Is there hope for me and for those I love in a world that seems so dark today? These are the kind of questions that come to hearts day in and day out and need to be answered. The great tragedy is that people concoct all kinds of answers. More money, more enjoyment, more power, and matters seem to get worse and worse. We need life-giving answers to real questions, and I think old-time religion has to change in order to catch up to them today. So, if you're interested in hearing where this might take us, we're going to look at these questions over the next 6 weeks. They're challenging. And the answers may mean that some of us have to metanoia, change our minds. Some of us are going to have to realign what matters most. And that's where I'm going to start next week. What matters most for Christians? And I'm looking forward to journeying through these 6 weeks remaining with you. Amen.